I like it. No, I didn't. I think, I'm not sure what Judy Monk's gonna come to this year.
Judy and Warren.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So we got a few more people, so we'll wait just a few more minutes. Father Lord, we thank you for allowing us to come again together on the night, during the week, and just take time out, busy schedules, I know a lot of us have, and to focus in on just a little bit of time, church history, and what we can learn from important events in the past. God, I thank you for the people here and their diligence and willingness to kind of stick through this. And God, even though, again, we're, you know, sometimes a lot of, you know, had a hard day and work and just other things, appointments, God, I pray tonight you give us a mind that can kind of push those things aside so we can focus the best we can on these few hours that we have to talk about our subject at hand. And to your glory, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, the last time we were here, we talked about these Germanic tribes. They were beginning to invade. You know, it's like everything's beginning to crumble around them as far as in the western part. The tribes are starting to take over. And sometimes, you know, it's not like the Hollywood version, you know, where they're just so, I mean, they were barbaric. I mean, they were uncivilized, but you can't blame them for wanting, they wanted what you and I have. Running toilets, running water, in a sense, you know. I mean, I'm being facetious here, but they wanted what the high civilization, who wouldn't, you know? And so they're starting to invade, and some of the tribes, though, were converted to Christianity. And we're going to find out in just a little bit, it wasn't Orthodox Christianity, it was called Arianism. This is going to cause a big problem. Arianism, this is another heresy, and it's a big one. In fact, it still exists today. We'll talk about that, how it does. In fact, it's about 4 or 5 miles down the road down here. And we'll talk about that in a second. But you know, remember Solomon wrote, there's nothing new under the sun. Some of these teachings that pop up in Christendom, as far as in the church, are things we've seen before. And this is why this course is kind of, you know, I think valuable, because you go back and think, well, how did they defend it? How did they put a stop to that? How did they nip that in the bud back then, you know, 1500 years ago? Anyway, so some of these barbarians were converted to a watered-down, sometimes heretical version of Christianity, which, you know, that didn't help matters. So they weren't Orthodox Christians. And so that kind of threw another monkey wrench in things. And we talked about the Visigoths coming in and moving across northern Africa and Spain. We talked about the Franks. You know, this is where we get France from. They move into southern France. And they weren't converted, by the way. They're the ones who held off. And that's going to come to play later on. And now, at the top of page 41, I think this is where we're going to pick up from last time. Italy probably suffered the most, because that's where all the money was. You know, that's where the capital used to be. That's where, you know, the church had its kind of capital, in a sense, at this time. And it was the Visigoths, obviously 410, who ended up capturing Rome. Later, the Vandals invaded. They sacked Rome from the south. So they were getting off from all directions. And in 452, the Huns came in, and the city was saved by a church official. It wasn't a city official who compromised and who made some negotiations. Because, again, where's the empire moved? To the east. Constantinople, the Byzantine Empire. And it's left a vacuum, and the person who filled that vacuum was the bishop of Rome. Not quite yet the Pope, but on that way, right? I mean, we're getting pretty close now. The Roman Catholic Church would consider him a Pope, but maybe not quite yet, but he's pretty much there. But anyway, the Huns came, and, you know, and at these other Germanic kingdoms were set up, but some of them just couldn't make it work. You know, they wanted to, but, you know, they're not used to, you know, how are they going to run all these things? They never had to do that before. So, you know, they try their best, but they just can't do it. Some of them last, some of them don't. After Justinian, the Lombards. Remember, these were the tall, blonde peoples. They came down into northern Italy. And number seven, civilization was progressively destroyed. Well, it didn't happen overnight. You know the old saying about Rome didn't fall overnight. Mm-hmm. It's true, you know. It was piecemeal. It was little by little by little. You know, there's so much to learn, you know, talking about. And by the way, now that we've finished the midterm, one of the things I did want you to do was find one story, one person, one event, and write, remember this, one of the assignments in the very beginning, write an illustration from that. How, here's an event that happened, here's a person, and here's something that we can take from it and learn today. You know, imagine if you're teaching a class, Sunday school class, or sharing with a friend, something like that, sharing with your spouse. You know, let me tell you a story about Polycarp, you know, and how he stood up strong, and you know, it's kind of like, and the so what? So all I want is a one page typed out, you know, give me what the event was, the person was, and then give me the so what. Here's the application. You know, like I try to do sometimes on Sunday morning, but I do a poor job of it sometimes. You know what I mean? It's like, okay, here's what we're trying to talk about, and then how does this apply to our lives today? You know, so that's what I would like. So that at least we can take one event, one thing, and kind of make it applicable in our lives to today, because that's what we're trying to do. And if you can just have it turned in by the end of the semester, by the end of our 10 weeks here, that'd be great. If you have any questions about that, I'd be glad to talk to you in between. We can talk about some of those details. I didn't want to make it long, just a few paragraphs there. So again, civilization progressively was falling around. The next generation of leaders in the church were then these converted barbarians. Fairly converted, not all the way. So think about how you're watering down Christianity. There's a reason we're going to the Middle Ages. The Dark Ages, the Middle Ages are the Dark Ages, because they're getting farther and farther away from genuine, kind of orthodox Christianity. You've got a mixture of barbarians. I mean, just kind of looking ahead, the big picture, right? You ask yourself, how in the world do we get to things like crusades, knights, and Christian warriors type thing? You know, it's like, isn't that an oxymoron, you know, type thing? And, you find people in the name of Jesus, in the name of Christ, in these feudalistic societies, they're harsh, they're barbarian, kind of a barbaric society. But you got to understand, these people their ancestors were barbarians. That's where Europe, all these people came from. And they formed Christianity. And the Christianity they came in contact with was very diluted. And they were barbarians, and they didn't really convert, per se. You know, it's like, okay, we'll take Christ and just add into the mix, in a sense, right? And their Jesus they got was not the one you and I know from the Bible. Does that make sense? I mean, how do you get to the Crusades and all this feudalistic system and very barbaric? Well, because Christianity that they got was not probably the real one, the one you and I would think of, and these were barbarians, not high civilization we're talking about.
It's like they described Clovis. Mm-hmm. He didn't leave his pagan ways, and he never adopted any Christianity in him.
Yes, and that happened not just over in Europe, it happened like in Latin America. Mm-hmm. You know, South America, when you know the Europeans came over and they were ready to convert some of these people, it's like, you know, they would sing the first chorus of Just I Am. If you didn't come forward, we'll shoot you in the head. You know, it's like, yeah. Guess what? Everybody came forward to the invitation time. It was amazing. But, you know, what kind of genuine conversions do you really have? And that's why you go to Latin America today, and there's a mixture, quasi-Christianity with leftover paganism. You see that in the ritual, in the way Christianity, it's like, you know, everything from the candles to other things, it's like there's a mixture. That's where we saw this with the first couple centuries of Roman. You know, it's like these barnacles attached to the boat, right? That's how it's happened a lot. Like, if there's not a genuine conversion, leaving everything behind, that's when Jesus says, hey, if you're going to be my follower, you've got to be willing to take up your cross and follow me. you wanted to crucify yourself. And everybody, you know, that still happens today. We see people come to church, and it's like, yeah, I'll take Jesus, but, you know, not really. He's just an attack on an add-on versus my Lord. You know, this is the idea that God says, you shall have other gods before me. The better translation is besides me. Nothing should compete for first place. Nothing, you know, it's like, here's God, and then everything else is down there, right? As far as the relationship of the church to the German tribes, the conversion of the Franks to Catholic Christianity. No, when I mean Catholic, I mean this Orthodox Christianity. Was very important to official Christianity versus the Arian Christianity. In 496, Clovis, we just got to mention it, king of the Franks, won a battle, and by calling on Christ and was converted. It reminds us sort of Constantine. You know, we didn't get the details there, but he, at the Battle of Milvian Bridge, 312, saw this sign of the first two letters of Jesus' name, the Chi Rho of Christos. I mean, whether he had that, I don't know. But it had such an impact on Constantine that he put that on the shields of his soldiers. And now the Roman Empire, imagine, their signet is the name of Jesus, in a sense. So whatever happened, it had a big influence on Constantine, to the point where he had a conversion of sorts. Well, Clovis, too. Here he's the king of the Franks, what we know is going to be France, and this tribe, and he was quote-unquote converted. And so you remember this old story, he commanded the soldiers, okay, we're going to all convert to Christ, Christianity, I need you to be baptized, and then they go down the water. But the one thing they can't let go of is their sword. So it's like, you know, can you imagine the scene, they're going down, it's like, okay, it's like, you know, they hold their sword out, and what are they saying when they do that, by the way? What's happening in baptism? What are you picturing in baptism? It's a death, you know, I surrender all except
my sword,
because, you know what, we got to survive out here, Lord. And you can't blame them in a sense, you know, I'm not saying it's right, but whether it was true or not, probably just a legend. But I always use this today when I talk about Christians in America. It's like, you know, when they go down to the water, you sing this, it's like the one thing they hold out is the wand.
I thought you were saying their cell phone.
No, God. All right, yeah, that too. I'll give you everything except these two, God. These are my guns today. You know what I'm saying? Or my sword. And that's kind of what it was then. But Clovis, he saw that Christianity, this was a path to civilization. I mean, he saw an opportunity, and he was opportunistic. He saw, and they wanted a higher culture, and that came along a lot of times with Christianity. Christianity, by the way, has always brought a little bit higher culture to a society. You ever notice this? It's the Christians who bring help and reason and understanding. Who is it that's built the schools over the years? Who is it that builds hospitals and nursing homes? And who is it that's been the leaders in science for many times? Newton or Copernicus and all those folks. But anyway, he was converted to what he thought Christianity should be, but it was, you know, again, it was a very diluted state still. And again, we got to judge him in terms of his own age. I'm not saying to accept it or condemn it, but a lot of times what we do as 21st century Americans, we put our understanding of things and put it on people like that. And that's not fair. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm not saying condemn or accept. I'm just saying we need to understand it was a much different time. We do that, it's like in Bible times, trying to understand some things. We want to see things the way we see it from 21st century perspective, and that's not really fair sometimes to do that. He lived in a world where the very idea that anybody could exist without fighting was simply just unthinkable, right? And it was probably right. You got to fight for survival back then. And so he didn't want to hinder the fighting spirit of his men. You know, he's like, I don't want to make these guys sissies. So he had them hold their swords up, if that's really what happened. But, again, Clovis, it says, gave up not a single this is one historian says, gave not a single pagan vice and adopted not a single Christian virtue. So it didn't change much. But a very important alliance, though, was forged between the leaders of the Franks and the Catholic Church. Western Roman civilization was, again, falling around, disintegrating, and the church was fighting for its survival, too. And here you have the most powerful tribe, and guess what? The Franks and the church, they need each other at this time. And so, you know, when desperate times call for... Yeah, and so that's what's kind of going on. You've got to understand the picture. You know, it's either fight or die, basically, in a sense, you know. And that's kind of, you got to understand the mindset, what was going on.
Well, they'd taken over a lot of property and farms and...
Yeah. The church did, so yes, they did.
Yeah, so I mean, they had all that to defend, too, from the...
Right.
The barbarians. The barbarians.
Yes, the hordes, yeah. They sure did. Later, the Franks defeated the Goths and caused them to, quote, see the light. Now, that light being, you know, but they were converted from Arian Christianity to Catholic official Christianity. So that was a good thing. You know, getting closer. And all the tribes which have been Arian Christians were now persuaded by the Franks to become Catholic Christians. Again, the conversion, again, it's either this or death. So, death or conversion, so sure, we'll see the light. Again, it was very kind of surface level, superficial. They didn't have a lot to convert from and to. And Arian Christianity, we're going to find out, survived really only in the East, and it still does. Not much in the West, but the Franks won, and so they converted everybody, because the Franks were such a strong tribe. All these other Arians, that was the controversy we'll see in a little bit, because they kind of dominated, they took over the Goths and all that, they kind of won the day. And boy, I'm going to tell you what, it's looking back, what would have happened if they would have been? What kind of Christianity would you have in most of Europe today? You'd have an Arian, probably Christianity. So I wonder how much God's hand was in some of this, even though they were still, you know, it's like God used the Syrians and the Babylonians, even though they were still ungodly. He still used them. I don't know. I mean, it's one of those things we'll have to get to heaven. God, would you, what part were you in here?
We
haven't
talked about Arian yet, right?
No, we haven't. We're kind of...
But I'm not sure what that means.
Yes, and we'll get into that. In fact, that's the very next thing we're going to talk about. Yes, because it's important that we understand that. So let me summarize this. Again, it's hard to visualize what's going on, what society looked like. It was very unstable, informal. You didn't have nations. You didn't have like the United States and Russia or even, you know, Germany per se as a nation. What you had these little towns, these cities that existed like a nation, you know, at cities themselves. So, again, it's so far removed from everything you and I know today.
Like a tribal concept?
That, yeah, in a sense, it was just on a larger level. You had a city that in itself was kind of like a nation. And instead of a nation, you know, much larger area. And alliances, you had to make alliances, you know, with this tribe, with that city. And everything was kind of in disruption and flux. You had old, you had the new coming in at the same time. It was so, again, far removed from anything you and I know in our world. That's why it's sometimes hard to visualize these things. And, I mean, we see the facts, we can read the charts, and then we can see the maps and all that. But even that, a lot of times, doesn't create a clear picture, does it? It's, you know, it's very kind of fuzzy. Everything is pretty much a mess. You know? Because the Western world is on its way to the Dark Ages. Can you see this? Things are disintegrating. Rome is falling. Civilization is on the way out in the West. Not in the East so much, but over here in the West, it's not good. It's a mess for a long, long time. Now, let's go to discussion 13, the growth of the papacy. Here we come to the Arian controversy as well in a few minutes. Again, we're taking each period on one subject at a time and looking at this topically. By the way, in a class like this, you know, we're just kind of skimming the surface. I mean, for 10 weeks, covering this much, you know, I mean, we could spend a whole 10 weeks on Augustine that we'll talk about here that we might get to tonight. You know, you could spend, I've had a whole semester on just, the church fathers. You know, I've had a whole class just on the Renaissance, the Protestant Reformation. So what we're doing is very difficult as far as the survey. I realize that. So we're just kind of skimming the surface, kind of hitting some highlights along the way. And that's why sometimes we go so quickly. Now we're talking about the growth of the papacy, especially in the 5th century, the 400s. The Bishop of Rome, now he begins to claim a little more authority, claim the authority over the whole church. Well, because, why? He's the last man sinking on a sinking ship. He's trying to hold things together, right? And yet the Bishop of Rome did not necessarily, have this authority per se in the West for another 500 years. And he never exercised, power in the East. He was just over here in the West. Roman Catholic was never Catholic in the sense of, quote, universal. You know what I mean? It was, well, in the West, it was Catholic, in a sense, but Roman Catholic is sort of a contradiction in terms. Either you're Roman or you're universal. Which one is it? Let's make up our minds here. So he may claim this. He started to claim this authority. That doesn't mean he's got it. I mean, it's going to be a long time before that comes to actualization. But he's starting to claim it where before, he would just claim authority over maybe one or two bishops over an area. Now he's starting to hold Christian empire in a sense. Then you see the important bishops in the development of the theory of papal supremacy. Go down to number two. Innocent was the first bishop again to claim universal authority. And then Leo, known as Leo the Great, sometimes called the first pope, 440-460, you see the numbers there, the years, was the first bishop of Rome to claim. Remember in the Bible, Matthew chapter 16, where this is where they claim the grounds of authority. Jesus told Peter, you're the rock, and I'm going to give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And of course, our understanding of that is the rock he was talking. He was a play on words. You're a little rock, but I've got a much greater rock in a sense. And on that rock, which is what he's talking about himself, I'm going to build my church on the fact that I am who I am. I'm the Christ, the Son of the God. That's the whole context of Matthew 16. Who do people say the Son of Man is? Well, all kind of different things. But Jesus says, what about you guys? Peter said, I know you are. You're the Christ. You're the Son of the God. He says, that's what I'm going to build my church on. Of course, the Roman Catholic Church takes it's Peter. It's Peter that the church is built on. And I think that's not what he was saying there. But anyway, he claims this, Matthew 16, is where they would get their authority from. In the same form that the Roman Catholic Church, again, makes that claim today. But again, it's one thing to claim it. It's another thing to be recognized by it. Anybody can make any claims they want, And so he begins to claim universal authority. And when the Huns, again, we were talking about this earlier, they stood before the gates of Rome, the civil authorities, they've all left Dodge. They're all out of there. And so Leo, here he is, he's dressed in these robes, high office robes, and the barbarians, they're like, a bunch of rednecks coming around. Wow, this guy, he's really dressed up, and they were pretty impressed. And he saves the city from being sacked, and burned. And he couldn't keep them out completely. But he did save them from a terrible fate. And they were impressed with this civilized man and his beautiful robes. It reminds you when Alexander the Great was going to, tradition says, he was going to destroy Jerusalem. And he was on his way down or back from Egypt, and the priest came out there with the Word of God, the high priest, dressed in all his robes. Remember this?
Yeah.
And he was so impressed with the scriptures that talked about him and, the high priest and his guard type thing, that he bypassed them. Now, whether that happened, for sure, we don't know, but one thing we do know, that Jerusalem didn't get sacked, didn't get destroyed, most everybody else, you know, took the wrath of Alexander, but they didn't. Anyway, so that's kind of similar to Leo. In 494, number 4, Glacius discussed the idea that there are now two powers in the world. You've got the temporal and the spiritual. And the church and the state each have its kind of own sphere. The church claims authority in all spiritual matters, like education, marriage, you know, I can't have marriage only twice. I circled that. Next edition, this will be a little better, okay? But where there's a dispute about matters that are spiritual, well, the church has got to decide.
It's funny to look at education as a spiritual matter.
Yeah, you know. And you know, again, this is totally different from how our society functions today. But, you know, with the question, what is spiritual? What is temporal? You know, and they would fight over this for 1,000 years. And they're still fighting. who has the authority? Does the emperor install the pope, or does the pope, you know, install the emperor? Right. And so who crowns who? Right. And they're going to go back and forth to this Charlemagne, and who does who belongs to Caesar and what belongs to God, type thing. And this was still an important issue even during the Protestant Reformation. You know, like if a priest commits a crime, a civil crime, murder, does the state then have the right to call him to trial? Well, in our case, we think, well, sure, yeah. But not back then. The church had their own courts. And he could be tried before ecclesiastical court. Again, that seems way odd to us because we have the separation of church and state and all that. But the church and the state during this time in the East and West were practically the same thing. It wasn't until, you know, a couple hundred years ago this idea of separation of church and state came about. But again, because they're about the same thing, there's a lot of tension. And they're going to fight back and forth through this. That's one of the main things you see. Then we get to Gregory the Great. And he goes to 596, 604. That's when our period ends here. Because he's such a pivotal transitional character in this time. And so many Roman Catholic historians, they consider him one of the greatest popes of all time. And by the way, that'd be a good test question, I think, for the next one. you know, how did the church become, you know, we're talking about land and stuff like that. How was it that the church acquired so much land out in the West? Well, I tell you, they were paying their penalty for their sin. That's part of it. You understand that in Roman Catholicism, even though your sins are forgiven, you know, well, that's great, but...
You can buy forgiveness.
Well, but you still owe a penalty. You know, it's like a little boy breaks the window. Okay, you know, you've got to pay for this. And so you could pay it ahead of time instead of spending as much time in purgatory, right? So how did you pay it? Well, you paid it sometimes by giving up land and things like that. And so it just, you know, you can imagine. People are willing to give up a lot of things if they think they're going to avoid, you know, 1,000 years of purgatory. I'll give up a few acres here or there, and you add that up. You got vast swaths, huge areas of land now that the Catholic Church has available. But Gregory himself was very pious, you know, sincere. A lot of these guys before were not, and even after, you know, the papacy is going to become so corrupt. At one point, it's going to be called a pornocracy because it just, you know, they got all these, affairs and children born out of wedlock and things like that. Anyway, but he himself was brilliant. He was a good administrator. Under him, the Bishop of Rome became the largest land owner in the West. People talked about this, left lands to the church to ensure, again, their salvation. And so he took these lands, and he was a good manager. He was a good steward of them. And he used it to not just, put in his pocket, but to feed the poor, redeem the slaves, and these captives. I mean, he was a very good man within this system. That's what I'm trying to say. Compared to a lot of them, as a civil administrator, he really dealt well with the pressure of these Germanic tribes. He was a good diplomat as well. Especially, he wore many hats, and he was good at a lot of them. He was an effective missionary, administrator. He was a musician. Y'all, you've heard of the Gregorian chants, which may seem very boring to us, but to them, they loved it. They liked that kind of thing. And he was an outstanding writer, theologian. So, Gregory the First, you know, that's just, again, a short synopsis, but did a lot of good things as far as within that system. Kind of stands out as you know, probably one of the better popes, if you're talking about popes in that kind of system. Now we come to this Arian controversy that we mentioned beforehand, and we're going back a few years because we're doing this subject by subject. So we're talking about the 4th century to kind of the middle part of it. And again, to put this in context, you got to understand there is a struggle to understand now the deity of Jesus, right? In light of that we believe, or Christians believe, in a monotheistic way of God. You know what I mean by that? We believe in not multiple gods. We believe one God, right? So how do you square that with, okay, Jesus himself is God, right? And you know, we've already dealt with this a little bit with Tertullian, who dealt with the Trinity and the Monarchian controversies, dynamic monarchianism, and modalistic monarchianism. And Tertullian comes on, like a lawyer, a good lawyer does. He gives us some terms that help us. He gave us the Trinity, you know? One substance, three persons, you know? God is one in one sense and three in another sense, right? And again, you get in trouble when you start to try to diagram God. You know, you just can't do that. Now, I do think Trinity is just as good as a word any word. It's not biblical per se. You know, it's not a biblical word. But, you know, it does give us a frame of mind, help us understand God. And so, this is another, though, controversy, because you're talking about now the deity of Jesus. How does he come into the picture if there's one God? And so this is one of those theological controversies, and it began with Alexander, who was the bishop of Alexandria, down there in Egypt, which was a large intellectual center. So you had a lot of people like Athens of the day and Paul who were, you know, doing nothing but debating and philosophizing, and you know, it's like a college town, you know, and Berkeley or something like that, where people the latest greatest ideas, they had time, I guess, to do this. And you have the Bishop of Alexandria, Alexander, and then you got another guy named Arius, who was a presbyter. He was a lesser figure. Remember, this is how the eldership has evolved. Because now, elder and bishop or presbyter were the same thing in the first century. But now you see how their bishop is bishop, you know, and you're just a presbyter. In the Bible, they're the same thing, but not by this time or not. They're the suburbs of Alexandria, and so they're going in. Alexander said that Jesus was co-eternal with the Father. One of the key phrases was, there was not a time when he was not. And he was of the same substance. Homoousion. Aren't you glad you came today?
Oh, yeah.
You got your Greek word. Homoousion. That's the one of the key words, the controversial words you're going to find here. And that just means of the same, homo, you know, the same substance. And so, with the Father. In other words, whatever God is, that's what Jesus is too. Put that in layman terms, okay?
It's in parentheses there, it kind of turned it around, right?
How's that
there,
here?
There was not when he was not. In parentheses. That's kind of the same as, you know, until he was, there was nothing?
A little bit different than that. It's just saying that he's always been.
Yeah.
You know, there was never a time that he's not existed. It's just, you know, in the Bible way, Jesus said, when the Jews questioned him, and he says, well, before Abraham was born, I am. And remember they picked up stones to stone him. Because who do you think you are? You're not even 50 years old yet, and yet you've seen Abraham. And that idea of, before Abraham was born, I am. That's the same etymology, the same words that God spoke from the burning bush to tell Moses when he says, you go tell them, I am who I am. In other words, that's where we get this idea of God's eternal, his proper name, Yahweh. Yahweh, or Jehovah, means the eternal one, right? That's what we're saying here. And this is what Alexander was saying. What you and I would claim, that Jesus is Yahweh. He is the eternal one. There was never a time that Jesus was not in existence as far as his pre-incarnate in the flesh state. He's always been. Now, Arius, on the opposite side, comes along, well, said that if Alexander were correct, then we'd have two gods, right? And so he's concerned about this. I mean, Arius is genuine. Still doesn't mean he's not a rascal, you know, because it's going to cause a lot of trouble, because Arius said that Jesus was not eternal, he was a created being. There was when he was not. Right? There was a time where Jesus was not. And he's of similar substance, homoousion. A little bit different word in the Greek, but it means a whole lot different. It means it's a similar substance, not the same thing, right? So that's one of these key words. Jesus is less than God, but he's more than man. You understand the arguments?
Yeah.
You know, you got Arius over here saying Jesus is not co-eternal. He was a created being. And he's less than God. He's more than man. He's less than an eternal God, but he's more than just a man, in a sense. This is the same views that a group holds today called the Jehovah's Witnesses. Do you realize that? Jehovah's Witnesses are Arians done over again. Picked it back up in the 1800s. It's always been around a long, long time. But their views are almost, in many ways, identical to, if you ever have a conversation with them, pick this up. So listen, this has been said a long time ago. You know, the church has already recognized this is heretical. And this kind of stuff can send you to hell if we understand heresy as dangerous as it is. So Alexander charged it was Arius, you know, that who had two gods, right? Because he got got a primary god and then a lesser god. And, you know, again, the Jehovah's Witnesses do this. They try to get themselves off the hook by giving Jesus a small g. You know, like John 1:1, they, in their translation, the New World Translation, which is a piece of garbage, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was a God. Now they mistranslated that on purpose. And instead of, you know, what it originally says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. You see what they've done? They've given him a little a, instead of, you know, God. By the way, you can't do that. That goes against the grammar in Greek. All the best Greek scholars know that. But you don't get yourself off the hook by giving a word, one a capital letter and then the other a small letter. If you got a God, guess what? You still got a God. And you got polytheism. And Arius didn't get himself off the hook. Jehovah's Witnesses, they don't get themselves off the hook either. But this controversy, it was going throughout the empire. And about the time, remember, looking back at the years up there, 318, 381, this kind of goes back to our other, almost, where Constantine becomes the emperor, and Christianity is declared a legal religion. It becomes basically okay to become a Christian. And now, the church is pretty strong in the empire as far as the numbers, but now you've got this controversy. Constantine is the emperor, and because now it's threatening the empire, he calls for a council. Okay, let's come together. We need to come to a consensus on this. And I, Alexander, or Constantine didn't really care about the giveaway at this point. He just wanted there to be peace and harmony because he's the emperor. And this is if the church is at odds with each other, it's not going to be good for his empire. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Politically, he's politically astute. He's like, you know what? Let's just call an official universal church conference, right? And let's talk about this. And that's where we get Nicaea. Nicaea is a little town over there, eastern part of the empire, close to Constantinople. So it's right there within his backyard. And he goes to it himself. And all the bishops of the empire body, 300 of them show up, quite a bit. Remember I talked about this, by the way, that a lot of them came injured and lame and, you know, one eye out and one leg gone, like a bunch of pirates, you know, coming in there. Because they were the generation that had been persecuted. And what a turnaround in one generation. Now you got to be uneasy almost. You're like, is this real? Pinch me, you know? I mean, he put on this big banquet. It's like, you know, it's like now they go from the doghouse to the penthouse in just a few years. And so things have changed quite bad. By the way, Nicholas was there. Santa Claus, St. Nicholas. Imagine mine. He was at this conference. There is a real St. Nicholas, right? Mm-hmm. It's just that it's kind of evolved to... what we got today, you know. And there was a big debate going on, obviously. And the council did put in, that they set these standards of, you know, orthodoxy for the church. And by the way, both sides, Protestant, Catholic, have accepted their decisions as kind of the standards. You know, especially regarding the person of Jesus. And it easily kind of rejected outright this idea that Arius had that Jesus was a created being. You know, even though there was a big debate, at the end of the day, you know, nobody really took the side of Arius, hardly, at this point. And everybody accepted that of Alexander, which was the standard understanding that Jesus is eternal. And I don't know, did I give you the Nicene Creed in your addendum? I don't know if you know, you don't have to read it now. But as that appears, it was revised. It's the revised form, which later on they had another council, and they changed some other lettering. But in the original statement, it was worded, "We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of all things, visible and invisible." Now, that's an important statement, remember? Maker of all things, because that ruled out the Marcionites, mm-hmm. who said that God was this... the God of the Old Testament is not the God of the New Testament. Because he believed in this dualistic type Greek thinking that anything physical is evil, therefore God of the Old Testament made the earth. Well, he's a bad God. And so this weeded out some of the heretics little by little. If you got to admit God's the maker, and the one Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, the only begotten of his Father, of the what? Substance of the Father, homoousion, God of God, light of light, the very God of God, begotten. Again, what this substance, whatever the Son is, that's what the Father is. You know, not made, being of one substance with the Father, whom all things were made, both which be in heaven and earth, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate in the flesh and was made man. This would rule out the Gnostics, you know. He suffered the third day, rose again, ascended into heaven. And he shall come again to judge both the quick and the dead. And we believe in the Holy Spirit. And whosoever shall say that there was a time when the Son of God was not. Now, they see that? That's a direct kind of quote against Arius. Whoever would say, well, we know who that's talking about. Arius, right? Or that before he was begotten, he was not. Or that it's going to be he was made of things that were not, or that he is of a different substance or essence from the Father, or that he's a creature, you know, he's just this created being, or subject to change, a conversion, all that say so. The Catholic and the Apostolic Church anathematizes them. You know what they're saying here? If you do not affirm this, you know what this is, by the authority of this council, we affirm you are going to hell if you don't repent. That's what they're saying.
Yeah.
I mean, they just call a spade, you know? And you see this first creed of the church, how it was dealing, we talked about earlier, with specific heresies that were coming up. So Arius and his followers, they were banned. And now it's interesting. The first time the church receives government enforcement of some of the decisions they made. And that was, what a turnaround. I don't think this was right, by the way. You know, asking the state now to, enforce, arrest heretics. It'd be like, okay, go arrest the Jehovah's Witnesses down here, you know, Sunday morning. They get together, they need to be arrested. Yeah, we laughed at that, but that's what happened. So it was a reverse, you know, and I don't agree with that, but what a turnaround. The church was being persecuted by the state, and now the state's helping them arrest the heretics. By the way, some other decisions were made at this first ecumenical council. They decided finally on a firm date for Easter. As far as, remember beforehand, there was Easter controversy, East, West. And again, the emperor really didn't care, I don't think, either which side, if it was going to be for Arius or it was going to be Alexander, just make it, let's nip this thing in the bud so that the church won't be split and the empire won't be hurt. So you have the apparent overthrow now of the Nicene theology, because the Arians didn't go away. They, in fact, converted the Goths. And now the Arians were strong. They had this whole group with them. And out of Nicaea, there emerged three different parties. You had the Nicene party, upholding kind of the Orthodox standard, led by Athanasius, who was a deacon, supporter of Alexander. He succeeded him as bishop. And he now becomes the kind of next guy to step up as a champion of Nicene theology, the eternal God, eternality of the Godhead. And then you got another party over, this small Arian party led by Eusebius. Not the Eusebius, the historian, but later he would become the bishop of Constantinople. He was a very unscrupulous guy. You know, he kind of bent the rules. But also, the important thing, he was in Constantinople. Who's in Constantinople? The emperor. And he's got his ear. And so, you know what? He's got a lot of political clout. And he uses that. He's got a version of Christianity that's really heretical. And he's got the emperor's, now, his kind of ear. He's got power on the throne. He knows friends in high places. And that's going to help him. And then you've got this kind of semi-Arian party, closer to kind of Nicene Orthodox. And they were kind of a grassroots movement that they just had a problem with the verbiage, with the way it was stated as far as the word itself, because they said that homoousion, that's not a biblical word. And because they felt it was tainted with other Greek ideas and things like that, and it had been used by other heresies in the past, this was kind of the common sense party, in a sense, some of the moderates. They said, listen, is it okay if we just agree, if we say Jesus is God? If we don't have to agree on that word, but we just agree in the sense that, biblically speaking, we believe Jesus is God, eternal. Is that okay? In our movement, we have tried to do the best we can to call Bible things by Bible names. And I understand that, because when you do get away from the Bible and you start calling things other than what you call in the Bible, it later on can cause confusion and contradictions. But if you just stick to the biblical language the best you can, I think that really helps out. Now, I understand why these guys were doing this, you know, using these words, because they were trying to fend off heresy. But these last group were saying, hey, can we just agree that Jesus is God and that's good enough? let me summarize this. The Arian minority, in common front with the semi-Arians, they temporarily imposed Arianism on the Christian world. Again, they manipulated the throne. They illegally attacked the bishops who supported Nicene theology. Again, they deceived the Nicenes, and said, hey, we'll go along with you, you know, but that wasn't true. all this is very complicated. I recognize this. You know, it's hard to keep in mind. We're not even done with these controversies of Christ yet. But especially Arianism, I do want you to understand some of the basics here. What was happening. And it was there, it was like a time when the empire was like, it's going to go to the point where it's going to be Arianism that was going to win the day. And remember the Franks, though, were converted. It was like, because they were so strong, they helped sway. Now, the majority of people was always Nicene theology. You know, that Jesus is eternally God. It's just, you know, today, it's like it's always been, even in Jesus' day. You know, you get people who have a liberal point of view, and I'm not trying to talk politics here, I'm just talking in general. Let me put it in Jesus' day. You know, the Pharisees in Jesus' day were the conservatives. They were really kind of the good guys. I mean, we see them as bad guys, but they were kind of the, hey, we want to, they were almost, they became legalistic in their views of the Bible because they added things to it, which was wrong. But they tried to stick to the Bible, but they didn't. They went too far to the right. But on the other extreme, we had the Sadducees, who rejected a lot of the Scripture. You know, and since they only accepted the first five books of the Bible, so they were kind of the liberals, the religious liberals of the day. And guess who controlled the power of the courts in the day of Jesus? The Sadducees. They were the liberals. Now, just in our day, that's the way it's always been kind of, we're in our Bible colleges. In our history, just our own Restoration history, some of our best Bible colleges got taken over by liberals and were sunk. College of the Bible in Louisville, Kentucky, one of our Bible colleges, there, J.W. McGarvey, eventually got taken over by people who didn't hold the Bible as inerrant, as authoritative. And here it's called the College of the Bible. And people who got in administrative roles, president and all those things, took over, and therefore, what happened was the conservatives, they ended up leaving, going to Cincinnati, starting a school called Christianity Bible and Seminary. And by the way, that's where I got my master's degree. So, you know, it goes back, you know, as to how that started. And it's always, by the way, it's still the case today in our colleges, not to mention any names, but there are still colleges out there today that kind of have lost or losing their way because they let people in as trustees, as administrators, who don't have the same convictions on the Bible that the preachers that they graduated did. You get these people who live and I retire. They never preached a day in their life. They've never been in church work. They've always just been in administrative roles. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. They've never been in the trenches. And then they get in seats of power. You know, when I was in Bible college, I had a professor who was 50 years in the ministry that taught us men how to preach. And he would tell us, okay, here's what you do in this situation, here's what you do in that situation, because he had been there and he lived that. Now sometimes you got guys in Bible college who, you know, I mean, they can tell you some stories, but it's not like they've been there and done that. You understand what I'm talking about here? Mm-hmm. This kind of thing has always been an issue. And I think that's where we have to learn our lessons from history. The Arians gained great ground because of their political clout and all that. That's why, hey, Super Tuesday today, I think it's appropriate that Christians use their right to vote. And, a lot of people have died so that we can do that. God's blessed our country to be able to have a voice. My hope is not in politics, but I'd be a fool not to participate and try to have a voice and, you know, do the best we can in a Democrat Republic way, you know, and even though sometimes, you know, the candidates maybe swim on who you want to vote for, but hey, you know what, you do the best you can in the system we have, it's better than a lot of systems, and, you have the Nicene theology finally did trump and triumph. Athanasius, though, compromised by proclaiming that believers, again, okay, we don't have to set that, you know, that specific word homoousion in order to be our orthodox. As long as you just affirm Jesus is God, fully God.
Amen.
And he forgave the bishops of Nice because, listen, they exiled him 5 times. He had to go away, come back, go away, come back. You know, because Arianism took over and they said, you're out of here. You know, they would send you to Siberia. You know, they would, you know, put you out and say, try to shut you up. And came back. You know what? He forgave those guys. Good for him. And I think it was good common sense to say, you know what? Don't worry about the word so much because it's not a biblical word. Let's just agree on the idea that the Bible's talking. And that's all these people want. These three Cappadocians, Cappadocia was an area in Asia Minor. So you had three leaders come from this modern-day Turkey. So three leaders of modern-day Turkey would be Cappadocia, these three bishops, Gregory of Nicianus and Basil of Caesarea and Gregory of Nicaea. They became the leaders who brought unity by interpreting this Nicene language in such a way to win the large support of the Eastern bishops. Again, they added the word hypostasis, which means substantial quality or nature. They offered this, I guess, a little less controversial, this one other word, homoousion. And although not really so much a change of meaning, but it allowed there to be some unity and still kind of follow what Tertullian was talking about. They used the word hypostasis to mean the same thing as persona that Tertullian was forming. Well, the value of, you know, Trinitarian form is not that it defines or completely explains the nature of God. But again, I think the good thing about that is it screens out some heresies. You know, again, you're at a loss if you're going to try to fully diagram and explain all this. And it's going to get even more difficult here in a few minutes. In 381, let's finish this up and take a break. The Council of Constantinople reaffirmed the Creed of Nicaea. They had another council, and in revised form, they struck the anathemas. You know what I mean? They eased up a little bit. Okay, maybe you won't go to hell, but at least they didn't state it as such, right? And, you know, we talk about this. Sometimes, when you state your case, sometimes you state it too firmly at times. You're so angry, you know. And they added some paragraphs about the Holy Spirit and that. All right, that's Arianism. We'll sum that up when we come back, and then we'll talk about some more controversies that, again, probably one of the most difficult things to study in church history right here.
What is Sabellianism? What is its name? You mentioned
Sabellianism is another name for modalistic monarchianism, and that is where they believe that God was, he came in three successive modes. You know, like he would appear as the Father, and then when it was time for Jesus, he would appear as Jesus. But he was never the Son and the Father at the same time. Then with the Holy Spirit, you know, Jesus went back, then God became the Holy Spirit. So it was modes. That's what they call modalistic. It was different modes of God, but not what Tertullian and how you and I think about is God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit existing co-eternally, the same time.
It's just another form then of the, well,
it's
got Arianism.
There's some lap. Yeah, there's some
overlapping there.
There's some overlapping. Yeah, we're going to see that. These things keep coming back up, a little bit different terms, but it's like, we've seen this before. Sabellian was a guy who became known for modalistic monarchianism. That's why he became known as, named after.
Okay.
The same thing, though. And that's why we're going to look at some of these controversies are named after the people who was their advocate, like Apollinarius and things like that.
Yeah, you start dropping names like this throughout, I'm going to have to question you.
Right. Okay, let's kind of summarize what's happened. This whole Arian controversy was a continuation of some other controversies, this monarchian controversy that we're talking about, Gary, dynamic, this modalistic, this you know, Jesus wasn't fully divine. It was like he was such a good person. God gave him the power, made him deity. It was kind of a continuation of this kind of thing. And again, it started heating up about the time that persecution is winding down. And one of the reasons the church could have a big fight like this was because, you know, during the period of persecution, what are you trying to do? You're just trying to hang on day by day. You're trying to, you know, survive one more day. You don't have time to debate some of these issues, really. So now that things have changed, and now you get a little more time to debate these things. And so when peace comes, you know, in the church with Constantine coming as emperor, then things kind of blew up. You had Arius from the suburbs of Alexandria, and Alexander from also Alexandria. And both, again, have pretty large followings. The emperor sees this happening and says, uh-oh, you know what? If the church splits, then we're done for. And so he called a council. And again, the vote was overwhelming in the majority of, you know, of Alexander, who affirmed the full deity of Jesus. And the Arians kind of misled the Semi-Arians. They had political clout. After Constantine died, his son, Constantinus, who got the East, was listening more to the Arians. And so they tried to win the battle by political means, but eventually failed. And Athanasius, with the help of these three Cappadocians, worked out a compromise. And pretty much, it's been a settled issue ever since. You know, I mean, both Catholic and Protestants, mainline historical Christianity, still follow the basic tenets of the Nicene Creed. Any doctrine that does not affirm the full deity of Jesus has come to be seen in most churches in Protestant and Catholic is heresy. And again, the Cappadocians insisted that not on the concept, not on so much on the word. Again, you get in trouble if you insist on a certain formula. So Nicaea did kind of preserve the unity of the church. Arianism never really disappeared. It existed in these small groups on the fringe, but not so much in the mainstream. Now we get to some more these Christological controversies over the nature of Christ. Again, this is quite complicated, I realize. Again, we're probably not going to study anything more complicated than this stuff right here. So if you walk away from this and you're really getting this, then I'm in trouble.
I thought I understood when I walked in, but I'm totally...
Good. And I'm doing my job. If you're confused, then we're right on track, okay?
First class was worse than this for me.
Yeah. Oh, the theology class. Yeah. Well, this is kind of what we're talking about now, theology, though. Mm-hmm. Theological. This is why I say, well, the best thing to do is study theology and history, because you study history, you're going to study theology. And you study theology, you come across theological concepts. Yeah, there's overlap here. Yeah, there's overlap. That's why it's hard stuff, but at least we need to try to have a basic understanding of what's happened.
Well, the history and the geography give you the environment that the church is operating in, mm-hmm. while they're trying to sort out all of this stuff.
Yes. Yeah, very well said. So once it had been kind of settled that, okay, Jesus is fully God, in the Nicene theology, the next question up logically, you continue to think about this, people think, well, what about his humanity? We thought about his deity, we've settled that, but what sense was he a man, a human, fully human? And the whole issue up to this point was about what sense was he God, you know, with a monarchian controversy. And this debate's going to go on for hundreds of years. There are different phases. The first phase is that of Apollinarianism, named for a guy named Apollinarius, coincidentally, by the way. Just happened to work out that way. Apollinarius, bishop of Laodicea. Remember, Laodicea is one of these churches there in Asia Minor that Jesus writes to, seven churches there. This is where the little city up there close to Ephesus and things like that. But he was a bishop there, and he'd taken the Nicene Orthodox side in the controversy with Arius, the Arian controversy. And the problem was, for him, how could he who is fully God be fully man. The question just really kind of disturbed me. By the way, have you ever thought about that? How is it that God, Jesus, fully God and fully man at the same time? So he's not the first and the last to think about this, but what happens is when you begin to try to diagram this out and you try to explain stuff that the Bible doesn't go in detail, you know, the answer is very simple. It's just, I don't know what it is.
Wait a minute.
The simple answer is we don't know.
It's very simple. I just don't know what it is yet. You know what I mean? I think it's one of those things that, you know, you'd have to be infinite to understand completely. And we're not going to be there. And we may never. We just understand by faith that these things exist. It's not for us to try to diagram, like the Bible gives definitions or descriptions of God, but it doesn't define God per se. Mm-hmm. God is this, God is that. But you don't fully wrap your mind around who God is.
I just, you know, I mean, in my mind, I think of passages and when he's on the cross talking to his father.
Yes.
You know, they don't know what they're doing. And in different times, which always led me to believe that there was God the Father and God the Son.
Absolutely.
And then when I hear, you know, we see these discussions, then it's like, well, if there's a dualistic God, then, well, is there? But then when you're in heaven, he's seated at the right hand of the Father. So, you know, again, so there's two.
Yes.
Right. So one in the other. So.
But the human side of it is he's got, you know, he still felt the pain. Mm-hmm. He still human emotions.
Yeah, he would, you know, he's so man.
God.
Okay, so see, we're talking about deity, now we're talking about humanity.
Yeah.
Where would those overlap? How does that work out?
Right.
Again,
biologically,
it's pretty simple, but again, I can't tell you.
biologically, it's hard to explain because you need two sets of chromosomes. And,
Do you need two sets, or how does God do that, work that out?
Exactly.
So,
but if you try to explain it biologically.
Yes. And theologically, too. If you try to you press the details too much, you're probably in trouble because God doesn't give us.
You get confused.
And so here's what's happening. That's kind of what's happening. And the cultural context is, you know, the Greek culture, the view of man was, you know, you had a view of the whole person as three. You know, the Greeks viewed, you had the body, soul, and spirit. Little s here, right? It's what's called a trichotomous view versus a dichotomous. Just a, you know, the body is, and the soul is the animalistic, the spirit is the will, this is the life part of you inside, this is the will part, the mind. Now, I'm not saying I believe this, per se. I believe man is twofold. You know, I believe man is body, soul, / spirit. I believe the Bible teaches that soul and spirit are the same thing. Now, I know some good people who disagree with me. And that's okay. You can still go to heaven. But the Greeks thought about it as separate. Body, soul, spirit, completely separate. And as far as how that comes over with Jesus, they would say, as far as Jesus' body, it was human. His soul was human. It was his spirit that was divine. Okay? That's part of, it was this divine logos, you know, that was the divine part, the divine spirit, the human man with this divine will. Is that my mind, the mental, spiritual aspect of Jesus was divine, that and nothing else. But that's part of what was going on here. Why this was not accepted? Well, the theory truncates. You know what that means? It really kind of minimizes his humanity. You're saying there's no human intelligence or will. Man is, only physical. Physically, man only physically, and so it kind of divides him. Because in the incarnation, what are we saying? That one of the key points is that he was like us. How could he be tempted like us in every way? If, you know, if in his, if you're dividing him like this, you know, he was only divine, not in his body, not his soul, just in his spirit. So I think it doesn't do justice to what we're, the Bible idea of, you know, the Second Ecumenical Council was held in Constantinople to discuss, really, for this very issue, just like Nicaea was held to talk about the Arius and the controversy of Christ and his deity. Now here you're holding another council talking about Jesus, this time with his humanity, and this time it condemned and exiled upon Arius. Get him out of the picture, you know, put him away, so he won't be in trouble. And the conviction was established as standard, orthodoxy, and demanded that the admission that the full humanity of Jesus, just like Nicaea demanded the full divinity of Jesus. Nestorianism was the second phase. You can see the years there in the 5th century, 428, 431. Nestorius was the bishop of Constantinople, and he didn't come up with this idea, but he was the one who kind of championed it. He was the leading exponent of the heresy which bears his name. His view was in Jesus there was a complete Godhead dwelling in a man, somewhat like God dwells in a temple, per se. Or in a man, but in the case of Jesus, it was a complete and eternal dwelling. Like a man could kind of dwell in a house, but at the same time be separate from it, right? That's sort of the analogy. But there was no combination of essences, no conscious moral union. It was it could have been broken if Jesus had been disobedient. The deity would have left this man, Jesus, right? You understand how there's a separation?
Like a possession?
Yeah, almost in a sense. You see that. You see how this, I don't think, does justice to the true biblical picture here. It was only at the ascension, by the way, where it was like the two melded and became together. After the complete obedience of Jesus was this, he was rewarded with this indissoluble unity with God. Jesus, the man, was essentially, before this, separate from God. Now, after the ascension, he became one with God. That's this view what he was saying. Let me give you a quote by him. He was formed in the womb of Mary, not himself God, but God assumed him. He assumed to clothe himself with humanity. On account of him who assumed, he was assumed is also God. In other words, that which was in the womb was not God. That's what he's saying. A man, but because Jesus, of his moral perfection, deity assumed him. We've already seen this with dynamic monarchianism. This is kind of retread. They'll put this on again.
Don't they contradict themselves with acceptance of the virgin birth and everything?
Well, they still believe in the virgin miraculous birth.
So where do they think they came from?
Well, they just believe it was still a miraculous birth, but the man himself in the womb, the fetus in the womb of Mary, was it that? The question is, was it God or was it man or was it both? And he was saying later on deity moved in, but he wasn't deity until later. You understand where,
I'm just being like the devil's advocate.
Right.
You're accepting the virgin birth, and how can you not accept that what is consummated the product of that birth isn't God?
Yeah, it's got to be, it's a God thing. Yeah. And this statement, by the way, became kind of the battleground, this idea that the womb, the fetus, was not God, right? Was he God in the womb or not? And so his opponent was Cyril, and he was Bishop of Alexandria down there in Egypt. And he, let me give you a summary. He said the human spirit was a divine spirit in the womb of Mary. By the way, this is almost exactly what Apollinarius said. And what did they do to Apollinarius?
Kicked him out.
No one seems to notice, though, because everybody is against, you know, this view, and they're so enthusiastic to do this view in, nobody notices. This is the same type of stuff that you just kicked out of the church, and it was very popular, and to go against, you know, this, and but his own view is kind of equally heretical as Nestorius. Again, nobody seemed to notice that because he was blasting Nestorius. He sounded like Apollinarius. That's what I mean. You know, Apollinarius, we just looked at, it's almost the same thing. He's just saying, listen, the womb is the divine spirit. And then this phrase, this idea of the mother of God, versus was he just human only? The mother of God, you hear prayers today from Roman Catholics, and they'll pray to, almost in a sense, the mother of God. That phrase, from this age, it became part of just, you know, you would say this in church, orthodoxy, liturgy, your worship. Later on, it was used to kind of venerate Mary, but not here yet. I mean, the veneration of Mary is beginning to evolve, to raise her to a different point. But this, think about it, the context is the fetus, the offspring there. Is it deity or not? And so, this is how they explained it. It's saying that what was in the womb of Mary was God, not simply a man, therefore Mary was the mother of deity in a sense, right? Mother of God, that was the original focus. Later on, it's going to be taken out of that context and venerated to talk about Mary in a sense of mother of God in kind of a different sense. But again, there was a lot of sentiment to raise Mary up, and he kind of took advantage of that. Nestorius had proclaimed that Mary could have been the mother of humanity of Jesus, but not his deity. Again, there was a certain watchword, certain key words, you know, through these controversies, homoousion. This one was theotokos. That's the Greek word for God-bearer, or you could translate it mother of God, one who bears God. That became that of the, not the Arian controversy, the Nestorian controversy. There, typo. Nestorian debate. The Nestorian debate, or the Nestorian controversy there, in the number two, and the middle of that, as homoousion was the watchword of the Arian controversy. This word, the Greek word theotokos, which means God-bearer, mother of God, became that of the Nestorian debate. I just saw that today, but that's wrong. If according to the Nicene Orthodoxy, Jesus was fully divine, Mary must have been, in some sense, though, at least a God-bearer. I mean, if Jesus was conceived of the Holy Spirit, is there a sense which Mary is the mother of God? Yeah, I think, in my opinion, in a sense, she was in the incarnation, you know, his coming in the flesh, only, not the mother of the eternal God. You know what I mean by that?
Number two in the Trinity.
Well, I mean, Mary was the mother of both God and man.
But how can she be mother and daughter? If she's his child, if she is God's child, she can't be his mother.
Well, who gave birth to Jesus?
Exactly.
Okay.
To Jesus, the human.
Well, did she not give birth to the divine too? That's what we're talking about here. See, that's the controversy. That was the issue. But they didn't mean that to venerate her, to worship her. They meant that to do away with the heresy that Jesus was just a man. That's why they use this word theotokos. That's almost the same mother of God, but she was the bearer of God. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're talking about here. Later on, it got used in their own Catholicism.
But remember, these guys, a lot of them worked in the basement where they kept the wine and the mead.
We do have to take that into consideration.
Again, we're not saying she was the mother of the eternal God in the sense Yahweh. She was the bearer of the incarnate word. That's all they meant by it. The key was he was God from the very beginning, as well as man, right? Appreciate the lip.
No better, no worse than a bedpan.
Yeah, right. I appreciate the laughs there.
Yeah, it was good.
But anyway, nobody really noticed though that Cyril also divided the person of Jesus. He succeeded in having the stories declared a heretic and exiled by the Third Ecumenical Council, and they quickly condemned the stories. But again, they didn't formulate any kind of statement of orthodoxy yet regarding Jesus. But he was rejected on that divided the person of Jesus. Well, we're not done. Monophysitism. Monophysitism. This comes from the word Greek word mono, physis, one, nature. Again, I think all these are misguided attempts to try to diagram Jesus, explain his incarnation. This started in Alexandria. The theory is Jesus, in Jesus we see a divine nature with human attributes. One nature. Versus what's been talked about as two natures. He was fully God, fully man. Here we just see one nature, and it's a divine nature. Now, this heresy spread in Egypt, and in fact, it's still around in some places. And then you have another one, monotheletism. Monos, thelis, I think I misspelled that, T-H-E-L-E-S-I-S, that's the Greek transliteration, thelos, will. You're talking about the one will. I'm not going to get into all this. It's very confusing. But I just want you to be aware of this and these controversies that involve the nature of Jesus. Was he fully? How is he fully God? How is he fully a man at the same time? And then there are... what happened was you had the church in the East badly divided. And that's going to help out when the Muslims come in, they're fighting among themselves, and it's a little easier to take over there because they're not united. And so that's one of the results of them bickering back and forth over these controversies, these theological controversies of Christ, these Christological controversies, as we call them. Today there's six groups there in the East, what we call the Middle East. Again, one of the most confusing things you'll study in church history, okay? So let's move on. Let's move on to, depends on how you want to say it, Augustine or Augustine. You know, this is the year from 350 to 430. As far as just some people evaluating him, you know, I could have quoted a bunch of quotes here, various sources. One calls him the greatest figure in the early church. You know, not counting apostles, right? Things of Jesus, obviously, but... one of my teachers put this, he's the father of Roman Catholicism, and when his teachings have been given such an overlay of superstition that men could no longer see them, you know, they're in the Middle Ages, the men in the Reformation age dug him back up, sparked a revolution that constructed the old foundations off of Augustine theology. In other words, what you got in Protestant Reformationism is not so much a getting back to the Bible all the way, but getting back to Augustine or Augustine. We're going to find out John Calvin really was a influenced more by Augustine than he was Peter and Paul. He was a student of Augustine. Problem with Augustine, we're going to find out, he was a student of Greek paganism, and that influence tainted his theology, at least in my opinion. He was born in North Africa. His father was a pagan. His mother was a Christian. He was a black man. By the way, you know, Augustine was named after him, and for many years there was such racial tension in there. It's like, I wonder if those guys knew that their city was named after a black guy. You know, all this tension, white and black up there for many years. Like, do you know who Augustine was? His parents had a lot of money. They gave him a good education. He became a teacher of rhetoric. And he became wealthy. You know what rhetoric is? It's like, you know, it's like a trial lawyer. Somebody that could state a case very well. And that day, by the way, sometimes it didn't matter the evidence so much. It just mattered how you made your case. Persuasion, right? It's kind of like in politics today, you know? Mm-hmm. The content doesn't matter. It's just how you say it, right? You know, if you're a good rhetorician, you know, we got some politicians who are smooth talkers. And that's what we're talking about. Somebody who could really learn how to make an argument. Well, he was good at that. As far as his own religious experience, he had a great moral struggle when it came to the area of sex. It's interesting, his theology a lot of times reflects to a degree his own religious experience. By the way, the theology people tend to write, it does that. A lot of times it reflects their own experience. We're going to see that when we get to Martin Luther in that class. A lot of his theology reflected his experience. Someone said the reason that Calvin's theology was so gloomy and deterministic and fatalistic was because he had kidney stones. You know, it's like, now they were kind of kidding, but maybe not. One of the reasons Augustine wrote into historic Christian theology this gloomy prospect of original sin and the depravity of man so much was because of his own life, his own record. He saw himself as totally depraved, and so that's how he writes his theology. I think it influenced his theology. Well, for 9 years, by the way, he struggled with sex as a teenager. He was a father to an illegitimate child, and that really bothered him. By the way, this was a time of asceticism. Remember that? Which was being glorified in the church. And so bothered him, even more in that kind of setting, that kind of context, where now all sexual urges were looked upon as being unworthy, even the legitimate ones. Now he has a kid out of wedlock, so it makes him feel even worse, right? And so he always struggled with this. And for 9 years he was a Manichaean. You're a Manichaean, and his teaching is dualistic Persian teaching, you know, kind of way out there, kind of New Age, we would consider theology before New Age was even invented. The old age, I guess we call it. And he left that, you know, way of thinking. He became a skeptic. He lived with a concubine. He had a child with this prostitute. He became a Neoplatonist, I think. Paultonist, a Platonist. And again, this deeply affected his thought. These ideas of Greek understanding. And so what he does, he takes his Greek paganism, right? For a long time, he was entrenched in a dualistic thinking that the physical is bad, inherently bad. That's what these dualistic times. Remember, we talked about this, Gnosticism and all that. He was along that thinking, right? And it's no coincidence that he's going to teach things that are physical are inherently evil, in a sense. Augustine came into contact with this guy, Ambrose. He's still not a believer. He was a skeptic. He went to check Ambrose out, who was this great Christian speaker, because he didn't care about the content, but he wanted, he liked his way he spoke. He's like taking notes, right? And I was like, oh, I can learn from him. And while he was there, guess what? His questions get answered. By the way, that's still important today, that people know how to answer the skeptic's questions. Because a lot of people out there, you know them, maybe it was you at one point, you had questions about Christianity. And a lot of people, those questions get unanswered because nobody is there to give it to them. And thankfully for guys, in a sense, like Ambrose, who done some time to study, to show themselves approved, they can be able to give an answer when people are ready to ask, and you're ready. And so that's what happened. Now here's his kind of conversion. The story is, in 386, he was reading a letter from a friend describing the life of the monks. Remember, that was kind of how, you know, people saw true Christianity. Set aside in Egypt, living this life of moral purity, which he wasn't, right? Mm-hmm. So in despair, you know, he goes to this garden. You know, and he overhears these kids are playing over here on the side. He hears this girl say, take up and read. But they're just playing with each other. So he takes that as God, you know, you're speaking to me? A very superstitious age, right? Just coincidental, you know, in my opinion, in a sense. But anyway, I don't know how you take this, but so he does. And his Bible, he got a Bible, he does have a Bible there, and he takes it up and he just kind of flipped it over. You know these people who do Bible studies like that?
Yeah.
This is what God wants me to do today. Now, I guess you can do that, and you know, but I don't suggest that's how you systematically study the Bible. You know, God can work any way he wants, but God's got a border and all that. But anyway, that's what happened. He turned over to Romans chapter, just happened to turn over to Romans chapter 13, verse 13 to 14, and it reads, this is what it says. Let us behave decently, as in the daytime, not in orgies, in drunkenness, nor in sexual immorality, and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus, and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the sinful flesh. What was Augustine going through? Struggling with sex and, you know, outside of marriage and all that. And he hears this voice, pick up and read. Picks up his Bible, opens it up. You know, the wind flips it open to this. You know, he's like, ah. And so he had this conversion of sorts. You know, he really did. I mean, he took this as a divine message. He was converted. He resigned his job. He went back to North Africa. He eventually became the bishop of a town up there in North Africa called Hippo. A lot of times we refer to him as Augustine of Hippo, right? That's how you know him. He lived there for the rest of his life. Basically, out of his house, he had this seminary, and a theological seminary. By the way, females were excluded. Can you think why? Yeah, okay, let's just don't have that nearby. He lived an ascetic life, again, because in his dualistic, paganistic thinking, the flesh was evil, in a sense. So you got to punish the flesh, right? He lived as a celibate. He became the champion of orthodoxy against all these heresies and schisms. He was a prolific writer. He was a good writer. His two most important works were Confessions, and this is kind of a mystical book, a transcendental, kind of abandonment of the rational world, that kind of fits into his style. But it is one of the great Christian classics. If you ever get a chance to read this, it is good. It's a story of his spiritual pilgrimage. It is valuable. He starts out in the opening statement, says, my soul could find no rest until it finds its rest in God. Probably his most famous work is that of the City of God. And this was written just after the Vandals had sacked Rome, right? Because look at the years there. Mm-hmm. Rome has just fallen. They moved up from Northern Africa. They've taken out Rome. It's kind of like, if you live back in that day, much less like you lived in Jerusalem, you saw the temple fall, you're thinking the world's over.
Kind of fast forward.
Yeah, as you get out of town. Mm-hmm. And the pagans were still blaming the Christians for everything. And so this was kind of his response to the skeptic. It's you, Christians. It's your fault because, you know, Rome is falling, civilization is going, and his theme was there was two cities. The city which man's always trying to build and the city, social order, which God is seeking to build, right? Man's state will always fall, but the city of God will never fall. And we're not talking exactly the same thing as the church. But in the Middle Ages, both the church and the state were to kind of identify with this idea of the city of God, the Christian society. This is what's been called Christendom. It was Augustine who kind of got this thing going. Now, whether he meant that as such, I don't quite know. But this is where Calvin picked this up, and in Geneva, he started his basically Christian society. You know, so he was influenced highly by Augustine. And we won't go into all this, we could, but those are his two works, and he was very influential, especially the City of God. Exactly what he was talking about. Some people have taken liberties of those. His theology, now this is interesting, his doctrine of God, he accepted the Trinity. But the key thing for him was the sovereignty of God. That is, he believed the only true free will in the universe had to be God, and it could never be thwarted. Could not accept the idea that God could generally will for something to happen and it not happen. Whatever happens is the will of God. His will trumps, and nobody else can have any genuine free will. Because that would mean he would have a free will. So, when it comes to you having genuine free will, you don't, because you would go against God's will. So it only appears as though you have free will. So it takes away the free will. Obviously, this goes against those scriptures that, you know, 2 Peter 3:9, God wants everyone to be saved. That's his will. That's his desire. Mm-hmm. But Jesus said, on the other hand, the road to basically heaven is narrow, and only a few people will find it. But the road to destruction is broad, and many will enter. Well, but God said he wants all men to be saved. Will all men be saved? No. Does that mean God's will is thwarted? Well, it depends on what will you're talking about. God, does that mean, in a sense, yes, it means what God wants sometimes does not happen, but it does that mean that God's not in control? Who gave man the free will in the first place?
God,
so doesn't that mean he's in control, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, so this is not so much a theology class. We've covered that. But, again, he was influenced by Platonic Greek thinking on this unchangeableness. God can never change at all. You know, he can never repent. He can never change his mind. Absolutely. He can just always has to be static, in a sense. So his understanding of man, his anthropology, that was what his great interest was, and kind of he's interested in himself, really. He was kind of very egocentric. And it evolved around three ideas: original righteousness, Adam before the fall, morally perfect, right? Original sin. Human nature became corrupt through Adam's fall, but by this he meant a complete moral inability. Not just depravity, but a total depravity. And Calvin comes along and he says, you know what, he was right. And Calvin takes this and he codifies it and he writes it down in his systematic theology. And Calvin becomes then one of the most influential theologians of all time. But he took Augustine's theology and he put it in a written form. And then you have original guilt. And that is, man not only bears not only Adam's absolute corrupted nature, but he also inherits Adam's guilt of his sin, which means he must be forgiven. And so through the influence of Augustine, infant baptism now becomes a kind of a general practice. Because if you did believe this, if you believe that your baby was born now with the guilt of Adam, right? Mm-hmm. What are you going to do?
Baptism.
You're going to baptize them, because they understood baptism was the point in time where the double cure was given, in a sense, right? But does the baby bear the guilt of Adam or not? You know, and that's where we're talking about our theology class. Original grace versus original sin. Romans chapter 5, verse 12 through 18, 19. You know, the idea that whatever, you know, my understanding is whatever sin, guilt we were going to receive from Adam because of Jesus, and God knew that he was going to send Jesus ahead of time, it wiped that out. It canceled it out, nullified it. But anyway, he taught this. This originated with Augustine, not Calvin. Calvin was a student of Augustine, right? That's important. Mm-hmm. Augustine was a student of Manning, a Greek and poor Persian paganism, right? And it is coming through his theology. You see how it's coming through? His doctrine of salvation. Again, if you believe this idea that God's got to be sovereign to the point there's no free will, and man is totally depraved, where you can do no good at all on your own. You can't even choose the right to do good, right? Even if you wanted to. Salvation, then, is holy of God. He elects you. That's why you talk about the elect. Are you one of the elect? Has God chosen you? Because guess what? You don't get a choice, Gary. You don't have the ability to do that. And because God's only will that matters, God, it's 100% God, salvation. And grace is irresistible. If God chooses you, brother, there ain't nothing you can do to get out of it. He's going to zap you, too bad. I mean, you know, if you didn't want to, you're going to go, he's going to bring you to heaven whether you like it or not.
Oh, I wish that were true.
Man's choice can be neither for it or against it. And the channel of grace is the sacraments, the result of salvation. What happens to salvation? Well, God has to give you faith. See, even faith itself in Calvinism and Augustine is a gift of God. By the way, that's Ephesians 2:8-10 says, "For by grace you have been saved, and this not of yourself, it is the gift of God." What's the gift of God? The faith?
The grace.
The grace. Now, if you follow Reformed theology, and guys like, who's that on the radio? R.C. Sproul. You're R.C. Sproul. You know, he's an interesting teacher. I totally disagree with him when it comes to salvation, things like that. He's a diehard Calvinist. Augustinian. Faith, understanding is not the gift that gives me faith. It's my faith. The gift is the grace. You right? But he taught God had to first miraculously change you, give you faith, regenerate you, justify you. I mean, everything is God. You know, where we teach, there's our part and there's God's part, right? My part is to, you know, believe, repent, and be baptized, and God forgives my sin and gives me the Holy Spirit. Well, they would teach God gives you everything. You know? So this is what we're talking about.
So your repentance isn't necessary.
Well, you
card that.
It would be necessary, but God is the one who caused it. Does that make sense? Because you didn't really make that choice anyway, in a sense, really. Because you couldn't, because you were totally, didn't have the ability, morally, you had a moral inability, you know.
You're a puppet.
Yes, basically. That's right. In the doctrine of the sacraments, a visible sign of an invisible, or a visible sign of invisible grace. Protestantism hangs on to this today. This is the standard definition of baptism by Baptist today. Baptists will use this idea of baptism as an outward sign of an inward grace. It comes from Augustine. I do not find that in the Bible. I don't find that in the Bible. That Augustine theology, it stems from his understanding of things. Also, Catholicism, they all spoke of them as a vehicle of grace, you know. Lord's Supper and things like that. His doctrine of the church, he attributed absolute authority to the church, not the Pope, but the Pope would later claim it. He attributed the church the sole right to interpret Scripture, not the Pope. But he didn't say exactly how this works out, but the Pope said, okay, I'll do that. As far as the marks of the church, it's one, as opposed to these heretics, holy. Come to God only through the church. Catholic, universal versus these schismatic, heretical groups. One, holy, Catholic, apostolic church. Bishops, in line of, you know, the Roman Catholic Church has added one word to the Augustinian formula. The one, holy, Catholic, apostolic, Roman Church. And the fifth mark is obedience to the Bishop of Rome. Next week, we get into this. You think of Augustine, however you want to say it. You also got to think of his critic, which was Pelagius, who taught kind of went the other extreme, in a sense. And we're going to find out there's going to be kind of middle ground there. So you don't believe in total moral inability, you can't do anything. Pelagius is going to go to the other extreme and says, listen, if you want to, you can live a perfect life without sin. But there's one people who's going to have a middle ground, a semi-Pelagic or a semi-Augustinian. It just depends how you see it. And this is important because it affects our understanding of, I think, theology as well. Okay. Hey, I didn't pass these out on your way out. This is just a pass those out here.
Quiz?
No, it's not a quiz. Yeah. This might help. This is a parenthetical study of these controversies we looked at earlier. Arianism. Look, you got the different types. Yeah, I sure do. I got several more. You got Orthodox. And then look, you know, how it just kind of gives you a little bit overview and describes what each view believes and puts them on one page. So,
thank you.
You know, maybe that might help out somewhat. If not, that's okay.
Once we get the definitions of some of these.
All right, guys. We
can copy them up.
We're done. Let's pray and then we'll do this. God, we thank you for another night. And certainly we've covered some things that are really kind of difficult and kind of muddies the waters on some of these things that we know are true. And we take them by faith because we know you're a God, that everything you've said comes true and makes sense. And so, yet we realize there's some things that we're not able to really diagram out in our minds because we're just limited like that way. But Lord, you've given us enough in your word to understand what we need to know about you, your coming, and how you were at the same time fully God, fully man. But exactly how that happened, God, I know I struggle with that. But God, help us to understand that you're the God who can do the impossible. And how that was really important, that we believe that you were both fully God and fully man, and how that was essential to take away our sin, and you took our place. But being God, you took it for everybody. And so, God, we thank you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yeah.